Hi, my name is Jakob Lundholm. I'm CO₂ Solution Manager working in Danfoss Industrial Refrigeration. Welcome to this episode about how CO₂ can contribute to the transition to natural refrigerants in an industrial refrigeration context. With the implementation of the F-gas directive in the EU, the path has been laid for phasing out HFCs even on a global scale. The good news is that we have several natural refrigerants that may do the job just as good or even better. And in these episodes, we would look into how CO₂ possibly can replace the HFCs and also be a good alternative to brine systems with glycol and so. The good thing about CO₂ is that it has actually been in industrial refrigeration for more than 20 years on the low temperature side. It is also becoming increasingly available and in many cases, or some cases, relevant also on the high pressure side. As an industrial customer, doing the right decision around refrigerant choice and system type is not straightforward. So there's also a need to support industrial customers in this. It might be that you have a local regulation which puts some limitations on what you can choose freely among. Could be the ammonia charge is limited due to a large density in the population in the area. It can also be that you are living in a very warm climate with very warm summers, where it's also affecting the efficiency of the systems differently depending on the refrigerant. As an industrial customer, you also consider to balance the initial costs and also the running cost. And the question about what do I gain from different technologies when it comes to CO₂ is an open question to many. Finally, the product quality, but also considerations about the availability of a qualified supply chain or personnel can also have an influence on your choice of refrigerant and system type. So supporting end customers in this is relevant, and why we also introduce this and the following episodes on how CO₂ can be a relevant natural refrigerant also in an industrial application. CO₂ can be introduced to the low temperature side as it has been done for many years in industrial refrigeration. By that, you can reduce the charge of any refrigerant you might have, whether that is HFC or ammonia, in a so-called cascade system. This you can do in two ways, either using CO₂ as a volatile brine, in this case replacing typically glycols. By that you can increase the temperature in the cascade cooler and gain efficiency. This is due to the that we don't have a temperature glide with CO₂ as you have with glycols. Then you also have the energy density of CO₂ being a volatile brine. Also reduces the amount of refrigerant being pumped around in the system, and by that you also reduce the pump work. The less refrigerant to be circulated also has the impact that you have smaller pipes, and by that you obviously save costs for that. Finally, your mixing station you don't need as you have in a glycol system, and also the maintaining of glycol also you can save. Obviously, it has to be set with the higher pressure as a volatile brine. You also have to consider how to manage the higher pressure that you have, and also how to manage the standstill pressure of the CO₂. Secondly, you can use CO₂ in a normal compression cycle, where you compress the gas being evaporated on the low temperature side. Between minus or below minus 30 and even down to minus 50, CO₂ has excellent properties and is superior to almost any refrigerant. This is again due to the fairly comparable good vaporizing enthalpy, and secondly also the density of the refrigerant at low temperatures. Then you can have, of course, also apply CO₂ on the high pressure side, and by that replacing the HFCs, for instance, in an existing system, it might be you have an HFC chiller where you would like to replace with a natural refrigerant, with a CO₂ transcritical system. You keep the glycol still, but have replaced the HFC with CO₂. That obviously could have an impact on the system COP that has to be observed. Finally, you can have CO₂ both on the low temperature and the high temperature side in a so-called transcritical booster system. This offers simplicity in the way that you only deal with one refrigerant, but doing this in an industrial context has some implications that we will look into in the following episodes. So thanks for watching and see you.